Okay, I got my cue. Morning, everyone. How are we doing today? There's a healthy buzz in the room, so that's wonderful. Come on in from the narthex and have a seat. It's wonderful to be in the house of the Lord this morning. I'm going to read a little passage from Colossians 1, or 1 Colossians. Okay, let's start again. How about 1 Chronicles 16? All right. And verse 1 and then 7 to 11. And this is a story, this is where David finally was installed as king. He was anointed as king many years before, but he was chased around by Saul. So finally, David was clear to be the king, and so he was putting things right. And so he brought the, that's where I'll start with verse 1. They brought the Ark of God and set it inside the tent that David had pitched for it. And they presented burnt offerings and fellowship offerings before God. That day, David first appointed Asaph and his associates to give praise to the Lord in this manner. So this is how he wanted them to give praise. Give praise to the Lord, proclaim his name, make known among the nations what he has done. Sing to him, sing praises to him, tell of all his wonderful acts. Glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Look to the Lord and his strength. Seek his face always. So that's how he was encouraging the Israelites to praise the Lord. So why don't we worship and sing praises to our Lord and Savior, Jesus? The Old Testament is full of mighty acts God performed for Israel. We, too, are recipients of mighty acts. So let's remember and be sure to give him the glory. So please stand.
We worship the God who was, we worship the God who is, we worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors, he parted the raging sea, my God, he holds the victory. There's joy in the house of the Lord, there's joy in the house of the Lord today, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. We sing to the God who heals. We sing to the God who saves. We sing to the God who always makes a way. 'Cause he hung upon that cross, then he rose up from that grave. My God's still rolling stones away. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. We were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. 'Cause we were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, and now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord today, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise.
I'm going to ask you to continue to stand while we sing our next song.
He became sin, who knew no sin, that we might become his righteousness. He humbled himself and carried the cross. Love so amazing, love so amazing. Jesus Messiah, name above all. Blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah, Lord of all. Body the bread, his blood the wine, broken and poured out, all for love. The whole earth trembled and the veil was torn. Love so amazing, love so amazing. Jesus Messiah, name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah, Lord of all our hope is in you. All our hope is in you. All the glory to you, God, the light of the world, Jesus Messiah. Above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah, Lord of all, Jesus Messiah, Lord of
Savior Jesus.
something about a name. Master, Savior, Jesus, like the fragrance after the rain. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.
Father, we thank you so much for giving us Jesus. We thank you for the fact that he became God incarnate, lived among us, and then paid a terrible price for our sins, that we might be free from sin and shame. Lord, what an incredible thing you've done for us. And we come here this morning to sing and honor and glorify you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Just take a moment and we'll give thanks for the offerings. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the way that you have blessed us with material wealth. And Lord, we give a portion of that back to you so that you might be able to use it in your service. And we just pray that our gifts would be glorifying to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So we have a baptismal service this morning. And I think we're going to raise the screen here so you're going to lose the lyrics in front of you. You have hymn books in your pews there, so turn to hymn number 469, and we'll sing verse 1 together while Pastor Dave finds his way into the baptistry. When we walk with the Lord in the light of His Word, what a glory He sheds on our way. While we do His good will, He abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey, trust and obey, for there's no other trust and obey.
Thank you, Bruce. Thank you, worship team. Good morning, everyone. It's great to be in the house of the Lord with you this morning, and it is great to be in these lovely warm waters of baptism. We are going to be witnessing somebody's proclamation of what Jesus means to them this morning, and we're doing that through the waters of baptism. It is one of the highest points of a Christian's walk with the Lord, and certainly one of the highest points of Christian ministry, church ministry, as we witness somebody declaring to God and declaring to other people their love for God. Baptism obeys God's command to be baptized. We are actually commanded to be baptized if we trust in Him. It follows the example of Jesus Christ Himself powerfully in Matthew chapter 3. I'll be reading that in just a moment. But it follows the example of Jesus Christ, His willingness to do what was right. Baptism also tells others or testifies, or what I'll say is proclaims, our love for Jesus Christ. And it publicly expresses the person's thanksgiving for God's love, for receiving them into an inheritance, being called a child of God. Baptism is patterned after the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, and so I'm standing in waist-deep water here, and as I lower Michael this morning beneath the surface of the water, it's symbolic of him saying, I'm willing to die to myself, and I'm willing to live for Jesus Christ. And as I raise him from the water, it is symbolic of the resurrection of Jesus Christ and the resurrection that all who believe in him will have one day, resurrection to eternal life. The water is symbolic of the cleansing that can come only from God as he washes away our sins. Today, we have the privilege of baptizing a man who is fairly new to our church, been here for a little while, along with his daughter, Gabriella, but whom I have found to be very deep in faith. You cannot have a conversation with Michael that doesn't revolve around God and particular thinking about God. It's beautiful. It's wonderful. And I've been encouraged by our conversations over the last several months. I'm excited by Michael's baptism this morning because he recognizes that his faith has been a journey. It hasn't been a moment, but it has been a journey. And that journey has brought him to this time in his walk with the Lord. I'm going to read from Matthew chapter 3, where Jesus himself was baptized, much to John's not wanting to baptize him because he didn't feel worthy. But Jesus came from Galilee to the Jordan to be baptized by John. And John tried to deter Jesus, saying, I need to be baptized by you, but you come to me? And Jesus replied, let it be so now, for it is proper for us to do this, to fulfill what is right. And then at the end of that same book in the Bible, Jesus gave the command to the disciples, and he said, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I will be with you always to the end of the age. Let us just pause for a moment as I give thanks for this opportunity for us to witness God's work. Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for the journey that you have brought Michael along in his life. I thank you, God, for the love that you extend to all people and how Michael has embraced that love and been so thankful for your offering of Jesus Christ for his sins. God, I thank you for his thinking about often deeply, Lord, and I thank you for the life transformation I have seen in his own life. I pray, God, that you will continue to protect Michael and guide him along his journey with you. This is one step, Lord, of many in his life, and I thank you and ask that you will watch over him. I pray, God, you will strengthen him for his journey ahead, and Lord, that he will continue to be a witness of your love, sharing with people how much he knows that you love him. So God, thank you for this time. Thank you for this blessing. And I pray your hand upon all that takes place today. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
So back to 469, verse number 4.
But we never can the delights of his love until all on the altar we lay. For the favor he shows and the joy he bestows are for them who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus, but to trust and obey.
I don't know that I need to introduce to you, but I will introduce to you Michael this morning. I encourage you also, in your bulletins, there is his testimony that he presented for this morning. So it is in your bulletins if you want to follow along. Or if you want to watch him read it, no pressure, you can. But this is Michael, and he's going to share his proclamation with you this morning.
The Lord is my light and my salvation. The Lord takes pleasure in those who fear him and those who hope in his mercy. For whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. As far back as I can remember, I always believed in God. I always believed in Jesus and the Holy Spirit. I was born in a Catholic family, but as I grew, I started to learn more by reading the Bible in my teen years. Later on, in my adult years, as I continued to reading the Bible and listening to some good teachings, I discovered more about who Jesus was and who I am in him. And even though I was baptized as a child, I struggled with the desire to do it as an adult. The desire became even stronger in the last 5 years. I want to proclaim my belief in him for myself. I want to be baptized because I want to identify with the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Like Paul, I'm here to say, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. The Lord has done many things for me, and it would take a lot of time to mention all of them. He's definitely the one who sticks closer than a brother. He is the one who is able to make me stand. I love many scriptures, as you have already heard me quote some. But now, I will close with a beautiful example of assurance in the salvation provided by Jesus Christ, who died on the cross to pay for my sins and then rose again to give me everlasting life. Ephesians 1, verses 13 to 14. In him, you also trusted after you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also, having believed, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession, to the praise of his glory. Amen. Praise the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Michael, thank you for your testimony, and thank you for your willingness to follow in Christ's steps in obedience to him. Michael, upon profession of your faith, which you have just given in your testimony, and according with the will of God, I will baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Okay, I'm going to ask you to turn to verse number 5.
Is loud enough that you would all hear, but I don't think anybody at home would hear without this. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Harmony Road Baptist Church. Welcome to all who are online. This week, I've been reading a bit in the Old Testament, and something I can see in there happens over and over again. As the Jews go forward, if they listen to what God says to them, and goes forward in his word and follow his instructions, they succeed. They overcome. But there were times when they don't seek God's guidance first, or they don't do what he's asked them to do. And then they suffer. And they suffer terribly. Now, we know God is a holy God, a righteous God, a just God, and he will bear absolutely no sin. He can't. But yet, in those times when they've disobeyed him, if they come back, they seek forgiveness, they confess their sins. He is a God of mercy, a God of love, a God of forgiveness. And he blesses them again, and they go forward, and they succeed. Now, that was then. What about now? What about each and every one of us? What about in our daily lives? We come and we sit here in the pews, and we listen to God's word. But when we go home, when we go to work tomorrow, when we go home to our families and our friends and our neighbors, do we keep God center in our lives? When we have to make a significant decision or an action or a function, do we seek God's guidance first? Do we give our lives to God? Do we take time to spend in his word and learn from him? Because the one thing about God is everlasting. We can't comprehend that in our minds, but God was there before the beginning, and God will be there after the end. And God never changes. So if God was like that with the Israelites in the Old Testament, will he not be the same with us? Will our lives not just be much easier and more blessed if we give our lives to him and seek his guidance before we make the big decisions? Think about that. I ask you to just think about that a little bit this week and go into his word and learn from God. And so now I ask you to bow your heads with me as we go before the Lord and we offer our prayers to him. Heavenly Father, you are an amazing God, for you are the God of all creation. You are sovereign to all that is seen and unseen, and you are the Creator. Father, we look around and we just marvel at what we see in creation. And that simply came from your word. All the beauty we see in nature, the joy we get from music, and just the love that each and every one of us feel in our lives from family, from friends, and most of all, from you. And I pray, Father, that we will place you center in our lives, that we will lean on you in times of fear, in times of anger, and in times of praise and worship. For Father, you want nothing but the best for us. You want to have a relationship with us. And we can have a relationship to you even though we are sinners, but Jesus paid for our sins. Jesus died for us so that we can have that relationship with you. And Father, please hear our prayers now. We thank you for the way that Mike has stepped forward in faith and obedience and professed your name publicly. Father, we ask you to fill him, to guide him, to protect him, and to help him as he goes forward in his faith life. We thank you, Father, for all of the good things that are happening within our church. We thank you that the refuge has received the building permit, that Nancy and Dave's grandson is doing well, and that Louise's family and friends in BC are okay. We thank you, Father, too, for just the way that your word does go out there in the world, and your word is present in the world. Father, there is pain and suffering also in our church family. We think of Terry and Rennie as they mourn for the passing of her mom. We think of Dave and Reese, who are still in emergency, and Phyllis, who's home but is having trouble recovering, still having muscle pain. We think of all of those who are fighting cancer, Linda, Faith, and everyone else in our church. We think of the unsaved ones that we know. Father, help us to be able to talk to them, to spread your word to them, to reach out to them and demonstrate your love to them. We pray for a revival among us and that we will all pray and study your word. We pray for that, for the pastoral search committee. Please give them guidance as we seek for a new pastor. And Father, we pray for the homeless and the marginalized all around us. Father, we pray that you will just lay your hand upon them, touch them, help them to feel your comfort, your provision, and help them to find homes. And Father, we look up to you as our God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. And we ask you to bless our church and help us to go forward in faith. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Am I on? Okay, thank you, John. I need the clerk. Thank you. You guys are on the ball. Look at that. It's great to be back with you this morning. It looks like there's more people here than when I left, so maybe I should go away on vacation more often. But it's great to be back. It's great to see everybody again and to reconnect with you. And what a blessing it is to be able to come back on a baptismal Sunday and be able to celebrate Michael's journey with him. We're going to continue in our study this morning in Christian counterculture. This morning, the challenge is that our culture will tell us, and actually we often believe this too, that the harder you work, the more successful you will be in life. And while that is true to some degree, this morning I'm going to challenge that as we look at prayer again in Matthew chapter 7. Because the idea of prayer is that we go to God and God will grant results. Doesn't mean we don't have to work hard. Don't read me wrong on that. We still have to work hard. But recognizing that God is the one who is in control of so much that is going around us. I'm inviting you to turn to Matthew chapter 7, if you will. And I'll be reading verses 7 to 11. Matthew chapter 7, verses 7 to 11. Ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, the one who seeks finds, and the one who knocks, the door will be opened. Which of you, if his son asks for bread, will give him a stone? Or if his son asks for a fish, will give him a snake? If you then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give good gifts to those who ask him? This is God's word to us this morning. Just let me bow in a word of prayer and bless this time together. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for your word, and thank you for the testimony that flows from your word into our lives. Thank you for speaking to us, God. And I pray this morning you will speak to us, that we will listen. This is not my message. Lord, this is your word. This is your message. And I pray, God, that we will all, including myself, be attentive to your message this morning. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So yes, I'm back for vacation. I spent a bit of time with Lisa and different times with our family members up at the cottage to take, you know, back and forth a little bit and having some nice breaks. And I had the privilege about 2 weeks ago of performing a wedding up there for a couple that I didn't know before the summertime. They had heard about me as being a person who can marry people, and so they contacted me a couple of months ago and said, would you be willing to marry us up on the lake? And so I sure, it's an opportunity. So it's a beautiful, beautiful story. When I first met them, I asked, how do you want this to happen? And they said, we want a beach wedding. And I said, you realize the water level is going to have to drop quite a bit for that to happen. Yes, yes, but we want a beach. What is the backup? There is no backup plan. I'm like, okay. That should have been the first warning. The week, the Monday before the wedding, on the Monday evening, we had an absolute deluge of storm water that hit our region and I think a lot of up in the Kawartha area. The water was so big that it actually overflowed a lake that feeds our cottage, and two beaver dams broke and washed out an access road that gave access to our cottage and about 100 other cottages down, further down, the only one way in, one way out on that road, and about 100 cottages, including the cottage where the couple was getting married at. So the Monday before, they could not get access to their property by road for a wedding of about 50, 60 people who all needed to come by road. Within a couple days, the municipality got onto it and they fixed the road, and that was great, but then the forecast didn't look so great. There were supposed to be some big storms that were coming through, and certainly the storms did come through. On the Saturday morning, on the Friday night, we were standing around and we were going through the rehearsal, and I said, what is your backup plan? And they said, we don't have one. The beach is now underwater because of all the rain, so we're going to have it on the dock. And they said, and it's not going to storm tomorrow. And I said, you have good faith. Now, these are people who don't necessarily go to church or anything like that, but they continue to say, it'll work, don't worry. And they're telling me this. On the Saturday morning of the wedding, it was a beautiful start to the day. Sun was like today, it was beautiful. Around noon, the storm clouds roared in like they only can up in cottage country. Big booming thunder that rattles the windows, light that almost blinds you when it flashes, and a complete downpour of rain that lasted for a lot longer than I wanted to for a wedding day. What was your backup plan? We don't have one. The wedding was set for 4 o'clock, and at the bride's vows in the ceremony that took place on the dock that couldn't take place on the beach, on a day that had stormed and poured rain for hours just before the wedding, the sun broke through the clouds, and the bride yelled out, the sun, in the middle of her wedding vows. And I had opportunities afterwards to talk with the families, and they were saying, someone was watching out for us. And I said, yeah, he was. And they were like, good thing you were here, Pastor. And I said, I think you had greater faith than I did. God answers prayer. And that is what the focus of today's message is. God answers prayer. It's simple in this acronym we see in Matthew chapter 7. Ask, seek, not. I didn't realize until this week when I was studying this that ask, seek, knock, actually the acronym is ask, right? Ask, seek, knock. And I was like, oh, God is so brilliant. And it all is about prayer. It's about prayer. In fact, going way back in time, the rabbinic literature all talks about asking and seeking and knocking as prayer language. It's not separate actions. It's not separate things. It's all part of praying. That when you're praying, you're vocally going to God about something. When you're seeking, your desire is for Him and things to happen. And when you're knocking, you're actively going out and doing things as part of your prayer. And the beautiful thing about ask is that the focus is on God. The focus is on God. So much of our time we spend the focus on prayer on ourselves and our needs and our shopping list of things that we need. But the focus is on God. And we see it so clearly in this passage. We see in verse 8, God says this, for everyone who asks receives, he who seeks finds, and to him who knocks, the door will be opened. It doesn't say that person is in control of any of that. It's actually referring to God who is in control of that. And later on, he says, how much more will your Father in heaven give good gifts to those who ask? Focus on God in this morning's message is, first of all, that God promises that he will, guys, next slide, please, that he will be answered. He will answer our prayers. When we look at Luke's version of the same story in Luke chapter 11, verse 5 to 8, just after the Lord's Prayer and just before this section that Luke kind of reiterates, there's a story that is told, a parable, in Luke chapter 11, verses 5 to 8. And Jesus said to them, suppose you have a friend, and you go to that friend at midnight and say, hey, friend, will you lend me 3 loaves of bread? A friend of mine has come on a journey, and I don't have enough food to offer him. Now, just suppose the one inside says, don't bother me. The door's locked, my kids are in bed, and I can't get up and give you anything. But then Jesus says this about this parable. I tell you, even though the man will not get up and give you bread because of the friendship, but because of your shameless audacity, I love that, shameless audacity, or your persistence, or even can be translated, because of your annoyance, he will get up and give you as much bread as you need. Moral of the story? Annoy God with your prayers. Seriously. Have shameless audacity when you come to God for what you ask for, because you know he is a promise-keeping God. He will promise to answer your prayers. Not always the way we want, but he will answer our prayers. When Jesus says ask in Matthew chapter 7, he does so with 3 very important things. First of all, he uses a present continual tense, which means continue asking. It isn't just like a ask once and then go away for a little while and then, oh, that storm has passed. Okay, ask again a couple of months later. It's a continual present tense, meaning that we need to continually ask God. Secondly, there's an imperative used in it, which means God is not saying, oh, would you please pray? He's saying, pray, 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 pray. Don't stop praying. And there's a universal aspect to it as well. Not just to pray for certain things, but to pray for all things. That's all included in what Jesus is saying. And in the parables that he talks about, when he talks about prayer, later on in Luke chapter 18, he tells another parable. And he told this parable because he knew that people will get discouraged in their prayer. And we all get discouraged in our prayer times. We do. All of us have to be honest about that. And he told this parable. He said, in a certain city, there was a judge who did not fear God and did not respect anybody. Now, there was a widow in that city, and she kept coming to him, saying, give me justice against my opponent. For a while, he was unwilling. But later, he said to himself, though I don't fear God or respect anybody, yet because this widow is bothering me, I will give her justice. Otherwise, by continually coming to me, she will wear me out. And the Lord said, listen to what the unrighteous judge said. Now, will God not bring about justice for those who cry out to him day and night? And he will not delay long for them. I tell you, he will bring about justice for them quickly. This woman bothered God with her prayers, is what Jesus is saying. And he's encouraging us to be so continual in our prayer before God that we bother God. I mean, I don't know that God can truly... Well, I think maybe God can be bothered. That's another thought for another message, maybe. But we are to come after God, asking God with prayer and seeking God and searching after him and knocking and doing things for him so that it is continual and with the great promise and the great encouragement that God will answer. God will answer. And why does God answer our prayers? Well, because we ask in a certain way, of course. No. God answers our prayers because, sorry guys, next slide. It's based on his goodness. It's based on his love. We see in verses 9 to 11, Which of you, if the son asks for bread, will give him a stone? Bread and stone actually could probably be pretty much, you know, hard to discern from a distance, you know, a little loaf of bread, a little stone, but they are totally different in their nature. Stone is not very nourishing and bread is. He says, or ask for a fish and give a snake. A snake has no nutritional, well, I don't think, probably snakes do have nutritional value, but the idea is that God will only give good gifts. And implicit in that is a recognition that you and I, all of us, are sinful people. We make bad choices. We do terrible things at times. But even people who are terrible, who are evil according to the passage, people who are sinful, even we can know what is good and bad, what is the right thing to do if we love somebody. So if you love your child, you're not going to give them something that will damage or harm them. If you love your child, truly love your child, you're going to give them something good. And Jesus uses the argument that if us who are not spiritually perfect, us who are sinful, if we can give good gifts to those we love, how much more can a perfect, beautiful, loving God give to those who seek him? Why do we love? Why do we ask? Why do we pray to God? Because we know how much he loves us. Because we know that he will always give us something that is good. Even if it is not easy, even if it is difficult, we know that God will give us something that is good. We have lived that journey the last few years of our life, as I know you've journeyed along with us. But God is good. He gives good things. You hear the challenges of David and Nancy's little grandson being born, such a small baby, yet it is life, beautiful life that God has given. In Matthew chapter 7, the focus is on material stuff. There's no question. Ask and seek, stones and fish and things like that. But later on in Luke's version of it, Luke actually changes it up a little bit, which is very interesting. In Luke chapter 11, verse 13, instead of saying, your Father in heaven will give good gifts to those who ask him, Luke says, your Father in heaven will give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him. That's powerful. Some people will say, oh, well, there's a mistake. You know, the Bible isn't accurate because one says this and one says this. Or maybe God is telling us both. That God gives all gifts, both material and spiritual. He gives material gifts to all people, recognizing his generosity and his love for all people. But he also gives spiritual gifts to those who are spiritually minded, who are sensitive to who he is. I'm not just talking about the list of spiritual gifts. I'm talking about continual spiritual gifts, the gifts of encouragement and love. And all these answers that God gives us that are based on his goodness and his love, all these answers should encourage us and spur us on to pray even more, to be continually in prayer with the Lord. So we pray because we want to, first of all, understand that God keeps his promises. Secondly, we pray because we know that out of his goodness, God loves us and will give us good things. But what does prayer do for you and I? I mean, it does have an impact on how we live. Ask, seek, knock. It does have an impact on how we live. So what are the reasons why we are to pray for us? And the first is, we need to learn to submit to God. We need to learn that we are not in control of our destiny, that we have so little control over what happens to us in life. Just this week, I had the blessing yesterday the blessing of being able to perform the ceremony for Rylan and Rachel, Rachel Moss, got married yesterday to Rylan Morey. Beautiful day, the sun, every stormy weather all went one way. Anyway, so we won't get there again. But it was a beautiful day, it was a beautiful time. But the underlying story is this. Rachel had two very scary experiences that week with vehicles. Where she could have been injured in either one of them. And yet the Lord has his hand upon her, and he got her to her wedding day. We are not in control of life as much as we think we are. The Lord is in control. We see this in the Bible when we see Jacob wrestling with God. back in Genesis chapter 25 and 26. Jacob, God wants to have this relationship with Jacob, and Jacob is like, you know, he's doing it on his own strength. And so they wrestle, and they wrestle all through the night. And then Jacob is unwilling to give up, and he's unwilling to give up. But finally, he gets tired, and he ceases with his struggle, and he realizes he cannot go on without God. And God just does the little boop to his hip. And Jacob can't wrestle anymore. He is humbled by the greatness of God. And once Jacob refused to be proud of himself, he surrendered and admitted his need for God. We all have to come to these places in our lives, no matter how long we're a believer, or if we're not a believer, we have to come to this place in our life where we will submit to God, recognizing his greatness, his power, his strength. Saul, the same thing in the New Testament in Acts. Saul was persecuting Christians. He was angry with Christians, putting them in jail, enjoying their torture and punishment, their death. He was celebrating all this. And then he comes in contact with God on a road, and he sees the glory of God, and bam! He comes face to face with the God that just hours before he was persecuting. And in that moment, he falls face down on the ground, and he's blinded for 3 days, and he goes without eating for 3 days, and he listens and responds to God, and he goes to the town that God tells him to go to. He surrenders to God. I know we talk a lot about surrendering to God, but do we actually surrender to God? I know we talk a lot about giving over this and this part of our lives to God, but do we actually surrender our whole life to God, like some of these men and others had to learn in the Bible? Do we get uncomfortable enough in our walk with the Lord? Do we get uncomfortable enough to take a chance for the Lord, knowing that he is a promise-keeping God and that he loves us and that he's with us? Do we go out there enough and put ourselves out there enough, or are we a little bit too shy and intimidated by a culture that really doesn't have a lot of good things to say about Jesus? We need to learn to submit to God. And that's what prayer does. We come before God. We ask him who is holy and above all things, God, have your way. Teach me. Learn. May I learn from you, God. Teach me how to follow you. Prayer humbles us before a great and almighty God. Second thing is, the reason why prayer is so important for you and I is because we need to understand that all things come from God. I alluded to this a little moment ago, but let me read from you out of Matthew chapter 5, a few chapters to the left. In Matthew chapter 5, verses 43 to 45, Jesus says this: "You've heard it said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be sons of your Father in heaven." So the key of being children of God is to love your enemies and pray for those who are against you. Why? Because he causes the sun to rise on the evil and the good, and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. Wait a minute. God sends good and bad to both believers and unbelievers? Are you kidding me? It's only believers he deals. No. Let me go back to the story I opened with this morning. I said God answers prayer. And all of you, I'm sure, were thinking God answers prayer because the sun broke through during the bride's vows. But the reality is, that prayer was answered long before that day ever happened. The prayer was answered months ahead of time in so many different and unique and beautiful ways. And I just believe this is a beautiful thing about God. I didn't know this couple a couple of months before I married them. They called me up. We got to know each other a little bit. They could see that I believe in God and I trust in God. And there was a bit of a connection that happened within the family. In fact, the mother said, "You know, I don't think this all happened by accident. I think we should keep in contact with each other." I'm like, "Oh, okay." But the bride and groom had to wrestle months before the wedding happened with the time of the day on the day of the wedding. And because most people will have like an early afternoon wedding so that they can do pictures and then have a reception. But this couple decided for whatever reason to have it at 4 o'clock in the afternoon. If they had chosen noon or 2 o'clock, they would have been pelted with rain and thunder and lightning, and it would have been a stormy ceremony. But they chose, for some reason, to have it at 4 o'clock. And, you know, God speaks to all people. And I believe God was bringing all these little parts together in that day to say, you know what, months ago, this is going to happen. Then a couple months later, this is going to happen. And then on the wedding day, this is going to happen. And there's going to be an opportunity for us to talk about what it means to have somebody watching over us. God answers prayer. He gives gifts to all people because he is a generous and loving God. But then there's also spiritual gifts, as I said earlier on, that he gives to those who believe in him. And we see this again where he says, how much more will God give us the Holy Spirit when we ask him? As believers, we need to call upon God knowing that he will not only provide all that we need for life, but that he will provide for us spiritually too. God's gifts are given to all. Those who do call on him, and even those who don't call on him, are blessed with his love and his generosity. And finally, the reason why we need to ask is we need to learn God's will. Sometimes we get this idea of prayer that it's like a vending machine. I don't know, anybody use vending machines anymore? But anyway, it's like a vending machine where you put the prayer in and you get a response out, you know? Kind of like a candy bar. It doesn't work that way with God. God doesn't work like a vending machine. There is not some unconditional response or answer that will come from God. He will answer, but it doesn't happen just because we do something. In John chapter 14, verse 14, Jesus says to the disciples, and it's actually interesting, if you have your Bibles, turn there to John chapter 14. And it's at a time where Jesus is preparing his disciples for when he's not going to be with them. And they are like beyond grieving, like they are messed up because they've been hanging around him for 3 years. Their whole life has revolved around him. And now he's saying, I am leaving you. And they are broken. And so he spends the first part of chapter 14 comforting them. But then right near the end, in verse 14, he says this, you may ask me for anything in my name, and I will do it. You will ask me for anything in my name, and I will do it. What is Jesus saying there? We need to have our prayers line up with what God's will is. And that's really the bonus and the benefit for us as believers, is as we pray, we start to learn what God is like. We learn who he is. We learn how God blesses. And our lives start to reflect on God's will, and we start to see how God responds. We learn what his will is through prayer. So when we pray about this 10 years ago, and God answered it in this way, we're like, oh, yes, that's a great answer. And then 2 years later, we pray about something else, or 6 months later, and then more and more. And we start to see a pattern of how God kind of responds. And maybe the responses are like this. Maybe they're powerful and wonderful, and maybe they're scary. But God, in the way that he answers our prayer out of his love for us, we start to see what his will is through our prayer with him. We need to pray. We need to pray because we need to learn to submit to God, to understand all the blessings that flow from him, and to understand his will. To ask God means knowing, trusting, and hungering for him. It isn't just a prayer that is shot out once every couple of months. It's a passionate plea to God to continually be involved in our lives, to show us who he is, to reveal his nature to us. Prayer is not just a morning thing that we do for a couple of minutes in our devotions, and it's not just something that we do in church on Sunday in a ministry of prayer. We are expected, we are commanded to go and pray continually to our Father. And as we do, he promises to answer out of his love for us, and he promises to reveal himself to us. In Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 13, the prophet says, then you will call on me, God speaking, then you will call on me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me, and you will find me when you seek me with all your heart. I will be found by you, declares the Lord. Will we make time to be that committed to prayer in this ministry year? I hope we do. Will we spend the focus in our board meetings and committee meetings and planning and our thinking about what we are going to do for God this year? If we're going to live counterculturally, what we need to do is take a step back and pray and pray and pray that God will reveal what he would have us do, and then have the courage to step out in faith and do what he asks. Let me pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you, God, for your word to us this morning. Lord, you are so good. Just to think, God, that the Father of all creation, the Father who has made all things, the intricacy of life itself, Lord, just to think that he is paying attention to us. God, that you pay attention to us as we reach out in prayer to you. That you listen to us. You listen to our fears, and you listen, God, to our joys and celebrations. God, you listen when we don't know what choice to make or where to go. And God, you listen when we're thankful for the success that you have granted. God, for the many blessings that come our way when we thank you for, Lord, you are pleased. Heavenly Father, help us to be people of prayer. Not just to talk about prayer, but to commit ourselves to pray constantly, daily, hourly, in our day, Lord, that we might see and discern your will and your hand moving among us. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Just before, I'll invite the worship team to come back up as I'm saying a couple of announcements. It is nice to be back. Yes, it is nice to be back. Good to see all of you again. Looking forward to catching up with all that is happening with us in this God's church. One thing I'd like to ask is if you are, I'll get out of your guys' way. If you are have a student or if you know a student you'd like us to be praying for who is in college or university, please send us to the church office here. Send us information about that student. So if what school they're going to, what program they're in, and that way we can produce a prayer list for our students who are away at college or university. We'd like to do that next week, if you can, so please send us any updated information on student whereabouts and what they're studying this week, if you can. And secondly, a reminder, and beautifully on theme, we have a prayer meeting next Saturday morning at 9 a.m. It's a Zoom meeting prayer, and we'll be sending out the link to our church family this week, so we would love to see more and more. We sometimes see 10, 15, maybe 20 people. Sometimes we'd love to see 50 people. We'd love to see 100 people in a part of that prayer meeting on Saturday morning. So please, please look forward to that prayer meeting. Set it aside in your calendar at 9 a.m. next Saturday and join us for prayer. Worship team.
Please stand. We'll sing together The Power of Your Love. Grace
reminded again of Michael's baptism. Thank you, all your family members, to come and support him on this day. And if any of you are thinking about baptism or would like to know more about it, please speak to me at some point or speak to one of our deacons about it. It's a wonderful opportunity for us to connect with God in a very intimate and beautiful way, proclaiming our love for him and knowing his love for us. May I ask you to bow your heads and close your eyes as I just offer this blessing out of God's word. To him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy. To the only God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, power, and authority through Jesus Christ our Lord before all ages, now and forevermore. Amen. God bless you this week.